Hi. In this second part, we'll deal with the following topics, starting with ceramics methods of fabrication. So right before the exam, in one of the revision classes, we discussed different methods of fabrication. So I gave you a few examples as well, if you remember. So if you look into the image, different methods of fabrication: pressed ceramics, example Empress, castable ceramics, Dicor, CAD/CAM machining, procedure, lava, inceram, zircon, etc. Right? Now let's move on to the next question. Histamine is released by which of the following? So various chemical mediators of inflammation are very important, and histamine is one such important mediator. So if you look into the image, so histamine, it's stored in granules of mast cells, basophils, and platelets. It's released from these cells by various agents, as evident in this literature. And the main actions of histamine include vasodilation, increased vascular permeability, itching, and pain. And also you can find the table with various chemical mediators of inflammation, which we discussed in our e-classes as well. Okay, now let's move on to the next question. Antioxidant vitamin. So we have various vitamins which have various important functions. Antioxidant property is one such important function. So tocopherol vitamin A is one such vitamin which has an antioxidant property. And if you observe the literature, vitamin E is a naturally occurring antioxidant which is essential for normal reproduction in many animals. It's also known as anti-sterility vitamin. So vitamin E is a name given to a group of tocopherols and tocotrienols. About 8 tocopherols, that is vitamin E vitamers, have been identified, which include alpha, beta, gamma, and delta. So among these, alpha tocopherol is the most active, and the illustration which you are seeing now is that of alpha tocopherol. Okay, now let's move on to the next question. Various adverse effects of ACE inhibitors. As such, adverse effects of various drugs are very, very important, as we emphasized on n number of times previously. So if you review literature, ACE inhibitors have the following adverse effects, which include hypotension, hyperkalemia, persistent cough, also rashes, urticaria, angioedema, dysgeusia, pitopathic headache, dizziness are something which are common, and granulocytopenia, proteinuria, and even acute renal failure. Okay, now let's move on to the next question. What's the route of administration of adrenaline in case of anaphylaxis? So if you review literature, in case of anaphylactic shock or angioedema of larynx, the Resuscitation Council of UK has recommended the following measures. And if you observe the literature, it's clearly mentioned that we inject adrenaline 0.5 milligrams, that is 0.5 ml of 1 in 1000 solution intramuscular, repeat every 5 to 10 minutes in case the patient doesn't improve or improvement is only temporary. This is only life-saving measure. Keep this in mind, which is very, very important. And adrenaline should not be injected IV, which can itself be fatal, unless shock is immediately life-threatening. If at all adrenaline is to be injected IV, it should be diluted to 1 to 10,000 or 1 to 1 lakh and infused slowly with constant monitoring. So intramuscular route. Now, let's move on to the next question. So in fact, we had this question in one of the very recent assignments posted knee classes. Failure of fusion of lateral nasal process with maxillary process leads to oblique facial cleft, as evident in the literature. And also, as I said, we posted the same in the assignment as well. So less frequently, other types of facial clefting are observed. Examples include failure of merging and fusion between the maxillary prominence and the lateral nasal prominence, leading to oblique facial clefts, or failure of merging of maxillary prominence and mandibular arch, leading to lateral facial cleft, that is macrostomia. Okay, now let's move on to the next question. Opisthotonus. So in which condition do you see this opisthotonus, and what does it mean? So if you observe the image and review the literature, so tetanus or lockjaw, it is a severe acute neurological syndrome caused by tetanus toxin, that is tetanospasmin, which is a neurotoxic endotoxin elaborated by Clostridium tetani. So the spores of microorganism present in the soil enter the body through penetrating wound, as you're all aware of. So in underdeveloped countries, tetanus in neonates is seen due to application of soil or dung on the umbilical stump. The degenerated microorganisms liberate the tetanus neurotoxin, which causes neuronal stimulation patient's spasm of muscles. So the incubation period is 1 to 3 weeks, which is again very important. The earliest manifestation is lockjaw trismus. Rigidity of muscles in the back causes backward arching or opisthotonus. So death occurs usually due to spasm of respiratory and laryngeal muscles. So as evident in the image, rigidity of muscles of the back causing backward arching or also called as opisthotonus, right? Now let's move on to the next question. Antifungal drug which has an effect on androgen production, ketoconazole, as you can see in the literature given here. So ketoconazole decreases androgen production from testis and it displaces testosterone from the protein binding sites. So gynecomastia, loss of hair and libido, oligozoospermia may be the manifestations as a consequence. Menstrual irregularities occur in some women due to depression of estradiol synthesis. Now let's move on to the next question. Which of the following is an essential amino acid or a non-essential amino acid? So if you review literature, you can find out the list of essential as well as non-essential amino acids. So essential amino acids are those which cannot be synthesized by the body and therefore need to be supplied through diet, and hence they are called as essential amino acids, which include arginine, valine, histidine, isoleucine, leucine, lysine, methionine, phenylalanine, threonine, tryptophan. And also we have these mnemonics like AV, Hill, MPTT. Or you can have or frame your own mnemonic to remember them. Non-essential or dispensable amino acids which the body can synthesize, and these are around 10. So these obviously are essential for various biologic needs, which include glycine, alanine, serine, cysteine, aspartate, asparagine, glutamate, glutamine, tyrosine and proline. Okay, now let's move on to the final question. Esophagus lining, which epithelium? So if you review literature, esophagus has a stratified squamous epithelium. So the mucosa as such lining the GI has three layers, which include epithelial lining, lamina propria and muscularis mucosa. So the epithelial lining is in contact with the contents of GI tract. The type of cells in this layer vary in different parts of GI tract. So especially the inner surface of mouth, surface of tongue, inner surface of pharynx and esophagus have stratified squamous epithelial cells. However, mucous membrane lining the other parts such as stomach, small intestine, large intestine have columnar epithelial cells, right? So these are some of the topics which I wanted to have a quick review on, and in the coming videos we'll deal with more and more topics. If you need any additional information, do let me know. I'll update the same in the description part of the video, and you can also post additional topics in the comments below. Wish you all the best. Love you all.